Mm-hmm.
So this panel, we have this topic of writers of the world. Here we have Halina Pawlowská, Gavin Corbett, Yao Emei, and Zhou Jianing.
我们今天晚上活动的主题是世界的作家，参与的四位作家是来自爱尔兰的 Gavin Corbett 以及来自捷克的 Halina Pawlowská， 还有两位中国作家周佳宁女士和姚乐梅女士。
Topic here, and we have very different kinds of authors with us this afternoon. And I think that it's going to be very interesting and challenging to know these authors' perspectives.
今天下午这一场世界的作家的活动，我们邀请到了四位作家，他们的风格都是不尽相同，而且是可以说是迥然不同的。所以我相信今晚的活动也会非常的有意思，对我来讲也是很具有挑战性的。Now
I will make a brief introduction of the authors in this panel.
现在让我来简单的介绍一下这几位作家。So
we have Halina Pawlowská. She is a successful Czech playwriter, short story writer, journalist, and editor.
我们Halina Pawlowská女士是一位来自捷克的成功的剧作家、短篇小说家、记者、编辑。
She has worked as a screenwriter and show presenter for Czech television.
她曾担任捷克电视台的编辑和节目主持人。
And then we have Gavin Corbett, was born in the west of Ireland and grew up in Dublin.
Gavin Corbett是在爱尔兰西部地区出生，在都柏林长大的一位作家。
His novels are Innocence, This is the Way, for which he received the 2013 Kerry Group Irish Novel of the Year, and Green Glowing Skull is his most recent novel.
他的主要作品有《天真无邪》《就是这样》和《闪着粼粼绿光的头盖骨》，其中《就是这样》这一部作品获得了2013年嘉里集团评选的爱尔兰最佳小说。
And then we have Yao Emei. She is a contemporary writer from Shanghai.
姚文梅女士是来自上海的一位当代作家。
She wrote Gone with the River Mist, which is an evocative novel that explores the lives of these four women as they each search for love, life, and dignity.
她的主要作品有《白话乌洛》。在这部作品中，她描绘了四位女性的生活，以及这四位女性在寻找爱、生命和尊严的过程中所发生的故事。
And then we have Jianing Zhou. She has published 7 novels and 2 short story collections, as well as Chinese and she is a Chinese translator of major English language writers such as Flannery O'Connor and Joyce Carol Oates. Her most recent novel, In the Woods, was published in 2014.
Zhou Jianing 是来自，也是来自上海的作家。他目前已经出版了7部长篇作品和2部短篇小说集。同时，他也是一位文学翻译家。他曾翻译过弗兰纳雷·奥康纳以及乔伊斯·卡罗尔·欧茨的作品。他最新的一部小说《密林》中发表于2014年。
So let's start this conversation. As we have in the description of the event, Writers of the World, we promised that we were going to talk about the writing life. So the first question is, for everyone to think about it, and then you will reply, okay? How is it to have a writing life? I mean, do you guys plan your writing moments every day? Do you have some kind of discipline, or do you think it's more like inspiration? How do you organize your daily life? I know Halina is a bit different because she's also a TV presenter, and I believe it takes a lot of time.
Sorry, I will only explain. I am a TV presenter, but I wrote 30 books.
Yes, okay.
So it's I offer.
Of
and
course.
Then, after that, I had a TV show.
What is
because I am offer.
Of course.
我们今天的主题是世界的作家，所以我们会围绕着写作生活这一个主题来进行我们的活动。我最想问的一个问题就是，写作生活到底是怎么样的？作家们是否会做计划，还是说跟随着灵感，还或者你们是否会制定一个时间表来安排生活？我知道海丽娜女士她是一位电视主持节目主持人，所以我也非常好奇。有关电视节目主持和写作生活这一方面，然后海丽娜女士刚刚解释说，我首先是一位作家，然后才是一位电视节目主持人。
Okay, so where should we start?
那谁先来回答这个问题呢
？Gavin, Gavin Corbett.
Well, my writing life is quite chaotic, really. I find I need time away from regular life to get anything done. My first novel was published in 2003. My second novel was published in 2013, 10-year gap. I think that tells a tale in itself.
我的写作生活可以说是非常混乱的，有时候我觉得我需要从日常生活中去逃离出一段时间，然后才能进行我的写作。我的第一部小说是在2003年发表的，第二部小说是在2013年发表的，这中间有了十年的空隙，所以我想这十年的时间也能告诉大家我的生活到底是有多么的混乱了。
My first novel, Innocence, which I have tried to disown actually, because it was a pretty bad attempt at a first novel, but was somehow miraculously published. That was written in a year that I had, that I took off after university, so I gave myself the time for that. And in between writing that and my second novel, This Is The Way, I just became embroiled in, a regular working life. I became a journalist. I made the very silly decision of buying a house, so I had to pay a mortgage. And I'm very poorly disciplined. I need energy. I need quiet to write. Eventually, I don't know how it happened, but eventually I pieced together my second novel, This Is The Way. And then my third novel, the discipline was imposed on me by the publisher because it was a two-book deal, so I had a machine gun pointed to my head.
我的第一部小说《天真无邪》是在我大学期间，就是大学将要毕业的这个时候写的。那个时候我稍微还是比较有充足的时间的。虽然说写作《天真无邪》的过程也是比较戏剧化，然后，但是它最终还是出版了。在我写作第二部小说就是这样的时候，我已经开始了我的职业生涯。当时我是一位记者。我需要在忙碌的工作中去找时间来写小说，我还面临着买房以及支付住房贷款的这些压力，所以我那当时感觉到我需要很多的活力，我也需要较大的空间。不过最终我还是出版了这一部小说。在我写第三部小说的时候，我已经比较能够适应写作以及写作这些所纪律性的一些规律性的事物了。
And finally, I find myself complaining and moaning about being a writer so many times. There's so many ways, if you're of a certain way of mind, a certain sensitivity, that you can be hurt. You can look for ways to be hurt, so many ways to be hurt, whether that be through status, anxiety, or lack of attention, anything like that. But every time I do find myself complaining, I pinch myself, I slap myself, I say, don't be so stupid. It's a wonderful life, it's a wonderful privilege to have eked out this little space for myself. And I'm very grateful.
我常常抱怨作为一个作家实在是太辛苦了，因为作家需要承受敏感的情绪，常常还会受到一些心理上的伤害，会感到非常的焦虑，会因为没有注意力而觉得难过，觉得痛苦。但是我每一次抱怨的时候，我都会提醒自己，不要再抱怨了，不要这么傻乎乎的，这是一个非常美好的职业。
所以我要打起精神来。Okay, thank you, Gavin. Your answer is very interesting and inspiring for further questions, but later. Now I will ask Halina. She's author of 30 books, and she has such a full life. How do you organize your daily life to write?
I want to tell it very easy. When I have contract with my publisher, I have to write. And so I write
obligation
all day, all night. I must have it because I have only 1 month or 2 months because I'm very lazy. So you know it's terrible for me. So I have to do it. So, and then I have it. I have 30 books.
Wow.
我接下来要问一下Halina，您写过30本书，您的生活也是非常的丰富而繁忙，那您怎么安排您的日常生活，来找时间来去写这么多作品呢？ Halina 回答， 首先我和出版商有合约，我不得不去写作。 我日以继夜的写作，我每一次的写作周期只有1到2个月，对我来讲其实挺痛苦的，因为我也不是一个特别勤奋的人。
Okay, so now, Zhou Jianing, Zhou, you can answer in Chinese.
中文，那个。 说一下写作的习惯，我因为最近这两天正好是最近这3个月正好是我一个非常标准的一个工作日程，非常典型。因为我一边在完成一本书的翻译，然后我同时在开始写一个新的中篇小说。那我的日程就会是我白天从早上9-10点开始会一直在做翻译，因为翻译非常非常消耗时间。 可能会做到3点左右，3-4点。那个时候已经精神方面已经衰竭了，然后就需要出去走一下或者去运动。然后可以。First,
I will talk about my writing habit. For the recent 3 months, I have lived a quite standard routine life. And because I am working on the translation of a book into Chinese, at the same time I am writing my own mid-length novel. Every day I get up at around 9 a.m. and start working on the translation. Translation is quite a difficult job, so it lasts about 5-6 hours, and I finish translation at around 3-4 p.m. And then I feel like I need to go out to exercise a bit.
然后晚上的话是我的写作时间，其实写作时间不是很长，但是其实对我来说，从整个白天从起床开始，整个翻译，然后到我外出，到我回来，到我跟朋友闲聊，以及当中回工作的 email， 种种这一切都是在为了。 晚上那可能两个小时的写作时间做准备，然后我写的非常慢，我每天只能写300个字，最多写500个字，所以说是一个很可怕的过程。如果我要完成一个中篇的话，30000个字的中篇的话，那我可能就需要写100天，3个月的时间。这个当中是一种对人的意志力的摧残和一种对你是否能够集中注意力的考验，就是整个是考验你，其实就这样，也没太大考验。
And in the evening, I will begin my writing. My writing actually only takes about 2 hours, yet I think all the time that I spend on translation, chatting, and replying emails is actually the preparation for my writing. But I write quite slow. Every day, I write only 300 characters.It's a very slow speed, and it is quite a terrifying process for me, because if I want to write a novel with 30,000 words, it takes 100 days to finish it at this speed. It could be said as a torment of willingness and an examination of my concentration.
Thank you very much. Now we have Yao Emei. Can you talk a little bit about how you organize your daily life as a writer?
现在我想问一下姚恩梅女士，您平常是如何安排自己的写作生活？
我是4年前开始职业写作，在此之前呢，白天都是有工作的。那个时候我会在晚上或者深夜吧。或者是天亮之前那两个小时，尝试过两种。当然，开始职业写作以后呢，我觉得终于可以把写作时间调整到白天来写了。可是我渐渐发现，因为太过松弛的话，白天的写作其实不一定有那个晚上或者是清晨的那个效果好。我正在调整当中，我觉得白天写作也是值得重新调整的。另外呢，我觉得现在中国做一个当一个妈妈，当一个家庭主妇，真的很辛苦。所以说，虽然我是现在是职业写作，但是往往会因为写很多杂志分析，所以我仍然不能算是职业写作，应该算是业余写作。
Actually, I just started as a professional writer 4 years ago.Before that, I was working as a part-time writer, so before I write before dawn or after dusk. And now I can finally devote much more time into writing, and I can write during daytime. But I somehow feel that this relaxing mode is not so efficient as before. And at the same time, I am a mother.And it takes a lot of attention for being a mother because I am constantly occupied by other routines and I'm still in this process of adjustment.
Thank you very much. So we can see that having a writing life, it's very different accordingly to different authors.
感谢各位的回答。现在我们都可以理解到了，对于不同的作家来说，写作生活都是截然不同的。
Okay, thank you very much for your question, for your answers. And now the second question is also something that was in the description of the event, so I don't want to go to off rails. And I would like to ask, what is the source of inspiration in this contemporary world? So find your inspiration. We know that traditionally this concept of inspiration, it would be something that we get from the nature and the beautiful views, etc. But I think that with these authors, we need to include this new digital era as well, so multimedia productions, So if you get inspired not only by what you read and what you observe and the beauty that you observe, but also if you feel also inspired by the people in crazy cities like the ones you live in, some of you, and also the media productions, the movies, TV shows, or even music. So I want you to talk a little bit about this.
我的第二个问题是有关于灵感来源的问题。我想问一下各位作家，如何在当代的生活中寻找到写作的灵感？一般来说，我们会从自然、从美景等等事物中所寻求到灵感。不过，我想问一下各位作家，在如今的新数字时代，面临多媒体 的这样的一个情景，您是否会从您所读到的几个书，或者您观察到的美丽的事物中获取灵感？在一些电视作品、电影，还有音乐中，您是否也会获取灵感？还有一个问题是在一些，你们是否也会从一些比较疯狂的人、比较疯狂的城市中得到灵感呢？
I'm inspired by lots of things other than books. You know, when I say books, I mean literature, fiction. I teach fiction in university, and I have used music in my teaching to demonstrate. Demonstrate the value of layering and how music can convey several things in one moment. It can convey something semantic with the words, but also an atmosphere with the mixing of the tracks of the music. And I try to get my students to kind of feed off the energy, sort of clone the energy of that create something dense and kind of latticed in their prose. So that's music anyway.
我从很多事物中截取灵感，在不仅仅是从书中截取灵感。当我说到书的时候，我指的是文学作品，还有小说。其实我是大学中的一位教小说的一个教授。在我平常的教学中，我都会向学生去展示一下我的价值观，我以及如何表达自我，如何向世界表达出自己的想法的方式。 我也会经常地提醒学生，从音乐中去获取能量，去获取一些灵感，然后再把获取到的灵感反映在他们的散文写作中，这样子才能够创造一些强有力的、有持续性的作品。Literature
is a very frustrating art form because everything is so linear. You must proceed word by word, sentence by sentence. So I think the more you can bring into the mix, the richer and more relevant, and the more reflective of modern experience and real experience it will be.
文学其实可以说是一个挺令人沮丧的一个东西，因为它是线性的，你必须要一个字一个字、一句话一句话的去写作，所以我也会觉得去把一些不同于文学的经验融入到文学创作中，是一个很好的创作方法。
My last novel, Green Glowing Skull, was an attempt to, whether it was successful or not, I don't know, but it was an attempt to convey modern experience, the experience of living in this virtual age, even though it was set in an ostensibly archaic world. I tried to convey the experience in the effects that the text produced in the sequencing of scenes, the sequencing of sentences, really. I wanted to create this kind of swirl of modern experience, which I threw everything in, rather like a Sichuan hot pot.
在我的最新的一部小说《闪着绿荧影》，《闪着阴影绿光》的投盖骨中，我也尝试着把一些很多的经验向大杂烩一样投入到这个小说中。我不敢说它是成功的，但我想说这是一个非常勇敢的尝试。这个小说它是一个发生在有一点虚拟的一个时代，并且带有一些无政府的背景的一个故事，在小说的 字面的顺序和场景发生的顺序中，我也想运用这样的方法来表达很多我的自己的想法。我可以把它比作四川火锅，把什么东西、什么材料都，所有东西、所有材料都放进去了。
It's a good metaphor. Okay, so the same question now to Halina. What inspires you, and also not only in your novels, but also screenplays, everything you write. You have to write so much because you have the contract you used to write. How do you find your inspiration? Do you have some rituals that you do? Tell us.
Okay. I am finding inspiration in the world around me. My own world around me. So I am looking for inspiration in my family, in life of my friends, girlfriends who are looking for love, for example. I found inspiration in my love and in the life of my children. And the greatest inspiration was my father, because he wasn't a normal man. For example, he loved to play with me special play. And this special play, I can name it. What if, it's to understand it?
Yes, yes.
What if? And so I am looking on the left and in my head, is this sentence, what if? For example, when I was 5, my father played with Mrs. Play, what if? And it was so that the sentence, what if you will be alone at home and to our door will come a murderer? Yeah? Can you hear me?
我主要是从我自己周围的世界中去寻找灵感的。我会从我的家人、朋友、我的女性朋友中去寻找灵感。我会从我的女性朋友寻求爱情的故事中去碰撞出一些灵感的火花。我也从自己的孩子的故事和生活中寻找灵感。但是我最大的灵感来源是我的父亲。 我小的时候，我父亲喜欢跟我玩一个非常特别的游戏。这个特别的游戏，如果我要给他起一个名字的话，我会这么叫做他：如果这样这样会怎么样？比如说，在我5岁的时候，我父亲问我：“如果你一个人在家会发生什么？”于是，我给出了他一个非常有趣的回答。然后，这样的灵感故事，这个
So it's like a very good imagination technique, because you imagine yourself in a situation and what if something happens?
Yes.
And you need to make a decision for you writing is like this.
所以这也可以归纳为一个非常好的想象力的手段，因为你想象自己在一个场景之中
会做出什么样的反应？Thank you.
Okay, now Zhou Jianing. 我刚刚想了一下，我觉得对我来说，我生活在一个困难重重的世界，所以我的灵感来自于 在克服这些困难的过程当中，你如何去寻找或者建构一个方法？
For me, I live in an age with numerous difficulties, so my inspirations come mainly from the process of overcoming these difficulties.
但我觉得我其实要比较感谢一下，不知道是命运的安排，或者是我自己在寻找解决各种问题的途径当中所建立起来的一种个人性格。我觉得我是一个很容易吸引到奇怪的人出现在我身边的人，就是所以说我的生活当中其实常能碰到一些奇怪的人和一些奇怪的事情。他们像一些珍珠一样出现在我的生活当中，我有的时候需要做的只是留意到这些人或者这些事情所散发出来的光芒就可以了。
And I also think I should express my gratitude to destiny, to the way I construct my personality in the process of overcoming difficultiesBecause I think I attract many peculiar people around me. I constantly encounter strange or odd people. They are like pearls in my life. And all I need to do is just to notice the shining spots of those people.
That is very interesting. And so for you, you find inspiration mostly...in society or in social environment, because overcoming the pressure of life is where you get your...
是不是对于您来说，灵感的主要来源是社会环境？因为在您克服生活压力、生活困难的过程中，您获得了灵感。
我现在觉得我刚刚说那番话可能产生了一些歧义。对我来说不是社会环境，因为我没有工作过，我是一个社会经验非常弱的人。然后我觉得我周围的奇怪的人往往是一个群体是跟我有共同特征的人，就是跟社会的实际的联系会有一些弱，他有的时候不是一个优点，有的时候是一个弱点或者是一个缺陷，对于很多人来说，但我没有办法，我就是在这样一个性格造成的一个自我的一个小宇宙当中成长起来的这样一个人。然后我其实也想去关照，就是跟我有着一样的境遇的这些人。
明白。
I think maybe the words I just said caused some misunderstandings, because social environment or society has little to do with my writings.Because I never worked as an employee, and the friends I have are mostly people who are very similar to me and who sharing some common features with me. So our ties with this society is relatively weak, and I think this kind of weak ties could be disadvantages. But I have no choice because I live in this little universe of myself for so long, and I attract people that are similar to me. But sometimes I want to go out of my own world and to care about other people as well.
Thank you very much. Yao Emei, so where do you get your inspiration?
杨女士，我也想问一下您，您是从什么地方寻找到灵感的呢？
我觉得我更愿意接受，生活对我的刺激，然后产生的灵感，我觉得是一个自然的一个物理的过程。但是呢，这种有时候也会带来一些尴尬，比方说有一次我正因为一些就是家庭方面的事情。受到这种刺激，然后我写了一篇小说，里面写到，当然不是我自己的家庭了，写到那个父亲去世了。然后当我小说刚刚写完的时候，我父亲真的去世了，所以这个事情就给我一个非常非常难以形容的那种难过和震撼。 后，我觉得自己还是要尽量写一些远离家庭的事情，还是要去写现实生活。
For me, I would rather accept the shocks that life have brought me, and I think the inspiration is a kind of natural and physical process. But sometimes I encounter some embarrassing situation in this kind of writing method. For example, I wrote a novel before. In this novel, the father of the protagonist passed away.And shortly after this novel was finished, my own father passed away, which is a really shocking and experience to me. I felt quite sad and quite bad about it. I even think about giving up writing about family life. And I think maybe I should just write about social life.
Yeah, that is...Wow, so I understand that you might feel that your writing has consequences in real life that's very, overwhelming and scary.
我同意您的说法，因为您，但是您对于小说会在现实中引起一些后果的这样一个想法，对我来讲也是非常有震撼力的，甚至说令我感到有一些害怕。
另外我觉得其实不是说去寻找灵感，我觉得还不如说比起说寻找灵感，不如说是等待灵感。我的方法往往是当你生活了一段时间，或者是你写作一段时间以后，办一个新的小说产生之前，我往往会去散步，很长很长时间的散步，什么都不要想，脑子里面空空的，就这样像白痴一样的散步。但这时候会有东西来找上来，我把那个东西称为灵感。
Rather than seeking for inspiration, I would say it is waiting for inspiration. And my own solution for this is to wait for a while after I finished my last novel. Sometimes when I have no writing on my hand, I would take a walk outside and I just wonder about.Without thinking anything, I just wander about like a real fool and wait for the inspiration to come across me.
Thank you very much. Okay, moving on to another question, also for all of you. Then I will have some individual questions, but I have for all of you. And changing the topic, writers of the world, I can't avoid to ask,do you like to travel? Nowadays there is this trend of traveling and posting in social media a lot of pictures and showing how well we are, how much fun we are having. People are becoming like wanderlusters. They have this hashtag on social media, wanderlust. Regarding this, I would like to askIs traveling important for you and for your writing? Do you use the knowledge you get from traveling in your books regarding the spaces, the geography, the different views? And do you use also some people that you meet when you travel in your books? Okay, that is the
接下来我也想问一个有关于世界的作家这样主题的一个问题。说到世界的作家，我就不得不谈旅行这样一个话题。在我们当今的社交媒体中，旅行变成一个越来越热门的话题，人们甚至以漫游癖为标签来发表一些社交媒体的贴文。所以我想问各位作家，对于您来说，旅行是否会影响生活，会影响写作？您在旅行中所遇到的不同的地方、不同的景象，是否能被运用到写作中来进行创作？您在旅行中所遇到的人，您是否也会以他为灵感，以他为灵感来去创造呢
？As far as I'm conscious of it, travel doesn't really inspire me or inform my writing, only in that it, you know, it gives me a chance to take stock of my life. I think whenever we travel or go away on a holiday or a work trip or something like that, we come back renewed and we come back vowing to do something, you know, kind of critical to do something to change the course of our lives.
Motivated.
Yes, motivated. And it is very easy. I mean, it is very easy to travel in Europe. Coming from Europe, Europe is smaller than China. You know, the geographical area of Europe is one China. Europe is like, it looks like, you know, the inside of a cow's stomach. It looks like tripe. It's just this little patchwork of like cells, you know, the tiny countries. Very, very easy to travel around.
旅行对于我来讲是一件非常轻易的事情，因为我生活在欧洲这样的一个大陆上，欧洲的很多国家都非常的小，面积都很小，而且旅行也是比较容易的，所以对于写作来讲，旅行的影响反而没有那么大，旅行更像是我从日常生活中所进行一场逃离的一个手段。在我每次从旅途归来，然后回到家中的时候，我都会去想一想我的生活的目的能不能有一些改变。这可能也是因为我所生活的地理位置的原因。
I'm sorry about using the analogy of a cow's stomach. I ate some for lunch. I'm afraid. Also, my novels are very much kind of concerned with Ireland and the Irish experience, which involves a lot of travel. Anyway, I mean, my last novel certainly, and the one I'm writing at the moment is about Irish people kind of reassessing themselves when faced with a kind of change of scenery, and that's very much the Irish experience. It's the Irish experience to go away for a few years, live somewhere else, and come back with the knowledge gained, or sometimes not come back.
我的很多小说中都是以爱尔兰人们生活的背景、生活的经验所为创造原型的。当然在这些小说的情节中有非常多旅行出行这样子的情节，在我的上一部小说中是有这样子的情节的，在我现在正在写作的这一部小说中，我的主角们也是爱尔兰人，他们正在开始重新评估自己的生活，他们也会去旅行，有时候他们将自己在旅行当中所获得的知识运用到现实生活中，有的时候他们一去不回。
I love traveling. I love traveling because, you know, our country is very small. Our country could be two our countries in one Shanghai. Our country has 10 million people.But I am well known in our country. I am very popular. So when I am going on the street, all the people tell me, hello, how are you fine, can we do selfie with you?
Yes.
And when I am here, I am normal people. I am normal woman. It's fine for me. And when I travel,I am looking for new feelings, and then after, when I come back, I will describe these feelings. For example, when I was in Africa for the first time, I broke my leg. It was terrible. I cried, terrible. Then after that, at home, I wrote very funny novel.About it. So.
我非常的热爱旅行。我的国家捷克是一个面积很小的国家，它的人口只有1000万人，就大概就相当于上海的一半。在捷克，我是一位名人，很多人都认识我。当我上街，当我在街上行走的时候，行人会对我说：“你好，我可以跟你自拍吗？”但是我来到了上海，我就变成了一个普通人，这一点也令我挺开心的。说到旅行，我在旅行的时候，我会去寻找一些新的感受，一些新的感觉，然后我会去形容这样子的新的感觉，并且把这一些感觉带到我的写作过程中。打个比，比如说我之前去欧洲，去非洲旅行，那是我第一次去非洲。但是我在这一次旅行中，我把我的脚部骨折了，这一次骨折非常的疼，我不禁的大叫大哭起来，这是一个非常痛苦的经历。但是我回到捷克的时候，我把这段经历转化成了一个有趣的好笑的小说。
我这边正好在写一个中篇，然后那个中篇的故事呢，它是发生在1995年的时候，美国科罗拉多州的一个很小的一个城市，我没有去过这个城市，1995年的时候我年纪也不是很大，然后但是我当时想要写一个艺术家的驻留项目，然后我觉得90年代的时候对于各个国家的年轻人来说都是一个变化很大的年代，所以呢，我花了很长的时间去查这个小镇的地理风貌是什么样子的，包括因为现在可以用 Google Map 嘛，然后可以用 Google Map 去仔细的看这个小镇上面的商店的位置，旅馆的位置，图书馆的位置，然后它周围的森林的分布，然后河流的分布是怎么样的，然后就可以通过这种方式，以一种很虚构又很科技又很实际的方式去进入另外一个年代的地球上面的另外一个城市，对我来说是比较有意思的事情。
谢谢。
At the moment, I am working on a mid-length novel, and the background of this novel is in 1995, located in a small city in Colorado State of United States. I've never visited this city myself, and I was very young in 1995. I wanted to write an artist in residence.Story. So I spent a lot of time on researching the geographical situation in these small cities. I used Google to check the map of this city. I checked the location of the hotels, the shops, and the forests and rivers around the town. So I think this way is at the same time fictional, technical, and very practical.It is quite an interesting experience for me.
Thank you very much.
关于旅行，我也是觉得，跟写作还是蛮有关系的。在我还比较年轻的时候，那个时候特别喜欢往外，但那个时候旅行跟现在不一样。那个时候火车很慢，然后交通也没现在发达，然后。人也很穷，我呢当参加那时候参加工作，没什么钱，但是特别喜欢往外跑。我记得从我们住的地方，往外走，要经过一座桥，每次只要出门，只要一上那座桥，我就心，我就会激动的心里蹦蹦跳，就是那种状态。因为我走过很多地方，我曾经最远的一次坐火车坐了3天2夜的火车到了新疆，然后我现在都记不起来一些细节。我记得当时跑到一个金鱼里面，可能是什么熟人带进去了，然后跟女兵住在一个寝室里面，一些女兵。以前我觉得女兵都是很漂亮、很朴素、很什么的，但是那天晚上发现他们也是蛮爱打扮的。
看板头大法师，然后编了很多很多的小辫子，这样睡觉，第二天早上起来把辫子解开，就那种胖的发型叫玉米须啊。那几年大约持续了五六年这样的生活。后来我写过一篇小说，叫像编一样，当我自己还蛮喜欢的，就我去编长篇小说。我觉得那几年旅行给我带来的后果就是，我觉得他们决定了我的精神世界的质地。我真的到现在都很怀念那个时候的旅行。这几年的旅行呢，对我来讲，不管去哪里都特别方便嘛。但是，我觉得更多的是一种休息，就再没以前那种感觉。
Speaking about traveling, I like travel when I was young.But traveling at that time is quite different from now because at that time the train is slow and I didn't have too much money as well. But I remember from where I live, I need to cross a bridge so as to go out. And every time that I cross the bridge, I feel really excited and my heart was pumping.And the train was very slow at then. One time, I took a train to Xinjiang, and the trip on the train lasted 3 days and 2 nights. And when I arrived at Xinjiang, I accidentally ended up into a military camp with my friends, and I got to stay with a female soldier in that military camp.I always thought that soldiers are quite serious people, but after that day that I lived with them, I found out that those female soldiers like to dress up themselves. They will make their hairs into braids and they feel quite happy about it. And that kind of life lasted around 4, 5 to 6 years.During that time, I wrote my first novel, As High as Sky. I love that novel, and I think it is the novel that inspired by my journey. And I really think that at that time, the trips, the journeys, they kind of have an impact on my essence of my spirit. And I miss that kind of life.At the moment, I still travel, but it is quite relaxing to travel now. Traveling is like rest for me.
Thank you. So traveling is very beneficial for writing, and it can be really productive. People go on trips and they get more energized and motivated to write about what they experienced.
感谢各位作家的回答，所以现在我可以得出这样一个结论，旅行对于写作确实是有好处的，它能够激发灵感，能够让旅行中所遇到的人也可以在写作中去获得新生。
Alright, so the next question is regarding globalization. So in an increasingly globalized world, what is the importance of writing? How do you think that literature can impact the world? We start with Stephen again.
下一个问题是有关全球化的问题。在高度全球化的当今世界，写作的重要性，文学的重要性如何体现？首先 ，Gavin 来回答。
That's a difficult question that probably requires a very complex and nuanced answer. But I think, you know, in this globalized world where everything is becoming so homogenized, the mall upstairs is like a mall in Dublin. All the shops I can find in Dublin, in Ireland.This city is moving at such a frightening pace. Skyscraper is going up all over the place, and cash has been phased out of the economic system. if you don't have a smartphone, you'll be absolutely lost in the city. Everything is paid for by QR code. So in a world like that, I think literature only becomes more and more important, because nothing reflects the complexity of life than literature. Something happens when you get into a book. Something happens with time. Time becomes so much more layered, whereas time in reality is like a dial that just is ever moving forward. But in literature, you get a sense of time in all its layers. It's a strange thing. It's called the chronotope, the literary chronotope. It was identified by a Russian theorist called Mikhail Bakhtin. It was only after I read about it, I realized that's exactly the experience of literature. It produces empathy for one's fellow human being. It breaks down borders, but that's not globalization, that's internationalism, which is probably a concept that so many people in this country can understand. It's a very noble concept. It's a concept that comes out of an understanding of the common good.
Thank you.
全球化这个问题是一个非常难的问题，我的回答可能也会比较的复杂。我觉得全球化它所带来的最显著的影响，就是它令世界上很多的城市看起来都特别的相像。在上海的商场，上海的商场和杜柏林的商场也变得很相似。这样子的发展速度令我感到非常令我感到非常的可怕。然后越来越多的摩天大楼高耸入空，经济系统也受到了全球化的影响。如果你没有智能手机，你有可能都没有办法在这样的世界中生活了，因为到处都是所有商店都使用了二维码支付。就文学的重要性来讲，我想在这样一个全球化的世界中，文学的重要性是越来越突出的，因为文学是最能够体现生活的复杂性的一种艺术形式。在现实中，时间是永远向前永不停歇的，但是在文学中，时间是可以停滞的。一位俄罗斯文学家曾经把这样的一个现象称作为文学停滞。我不知道这个概念是怎么样去解释的，但我觉得这是一个非常高深也非常值得我们探讨的一个概念。因为在文学中，你可以获得一段空白的一段时间去进行探索和创造。
Thank you very much. Halina, it's a very difficult question. I think that, but the word when I think it only on literature, that the word was globalized the first day it was done.Because the first day started love, hating, passions, and I think that the right literature is about these things. When somebody born was death, love, and so on.
全球化对我来讲也是一个很困难的一个话题，但是我个人认为，其实全球化从世界被创造出来的第一天就开始了，因为在那一个时候，人们就开始了爱，开始恨，开始拥有不同的激情，而文学的主题就是有关于人类的这一些情感，有关于爱恨，有关于死亡，所以我认为，全球化从人类被创造出的第一天就开始了，文学也是一直都很重要的。
对我来说，我觉得全球化像是 从某种程度上来说像是一个幻觉，这就好像把上海这个城市放在中国来谈论的话，从某种程度来说它也是一种幻觉。另外我觉得一方面来说，大家都觉得整个世界变得越来越容易沟通，但正是在这种容易沟通当中才会涌现出一种更明确的更清晰的不可沟通性。而我觉得这个时代的文学并不会产生在那个容易沟通的那部分内容当中，而会产生在那部分不可沟通的麻烦和问题当中。
For me, I think globalization is actually a mirage or an illusion, and Shanghai could be as well described as an illusion. It is seemingly easier to communicate in this age, but I still think there is something that's impossible to communicate, and I think that if literature should be existing in some places,it should be existing in that place that the communication is difficult.
Thank you.
我觉得这个话可能 让我们更容易看到这个世界上各个地方的文化和生活。比方说我们可以很容易发现一个美国青年在怎么生活，一个英国人在怎么生活，一个中国人，一个韩国人，我们很容易都可以了解到。但是这个人的内心世界里面他了解，我觉得这是文学的功能所在。文学它能够让你打开那个人的内心，打开很多表面上你每天就是耳朵能想的事情，其实背后有很多我们都知道的。我觉得文学应该是打开那些常见里面的不常见的东西，就这个。但是这个东西就算全球化，不管全球化的程度怎么加剧，这个东西是我看不到的，只有通过文学或者电影这样的手段可以让我们更加了解。
Globalization makes it easier for everyone to see the life of other people living in other countries. We can easily know the life of people in US, China, or in South Korea. Yet, however, we cannot see the inner world or the psychological world of those people. But literature can help us get through the surface and get through the familiar things in life.And to arrive at the unfamiliar places. No matter how fast globalization goes, it cannot make people to see the life, the inner life of others. Only literature and movie can do that.
Thank you very much. Now I have a question for each of you. We are don't have many time, but just a quick question regarding.Individually, the authors here. So I will start with Halina. Do you believe that there's a fight between TV and books?
Oh, it's a terrible question. No, it's not a terrible question, it's a terrible to answer. Because I don't know.
Do you think that?
I think that the people globally prefer to look, like to think. So maybe to look only on the words is more difficult than to look only on the picture. And TV.Give us a picture, mostly picture. And, you know, everybody from you have mobile, these pictures. Only few words to pictures. So I'm afraid, but I am not so young. I think for me, it's a period will continue okay. But the younger writers, it's everybody younger writers here, it will be difficult.
Thank you. 我接下来会问一些针对每个作家的不同的问题。首先我想问一下 Halina 一个有关于电视和书籍的问题，您是怎么看待电视对阅读对阅读书籍所产生的影响呢？ Halina 回答，这个问题应该说有点可怕，这个问题并不是可怕的，但是我的回答可能会有一些可怕，因为电视会给我们带来很多的图像，但是书籍所能呈现的就是一些字面上的东西。而我认为大多数人他们都更擅长于观看图像，而不擅长于去思考字面背后的意思。现在我们所有人都拥有自己的手机，手机上也会有很多的图像呈现，这可能就会导致人们越来越不善于思考一些深沉的东西。可能对于我来讲这个影响并不是太大的，但是对于一些更年轻的读者更年轻的作家来说，这样的影响会是比较深远的。
Thank you very much. Now I will ask Gavin Corbett. I read some interviews that youI was very interested in something that you said by the end of one of those interviews. You suggested young men to put their enigma, smilers, and salters away and read some women. and I liked that sentence. Could you tell us more about this thought?
我接下来的问题是问 Gavin 的。我看了一些你的访谈，你在访谈中建议年轻人放下手中海明威、萨尔登等男性作家的书，去阅读一些女性作家的作品。您能不能就这一点和我们再谈一下您更多的想法呢？
Wow, you really went back in time to get that quote.
Maybe.
You know, I'm writing a book.written from the perspective of a woman, and in the course of writing that book, perhaps I've changed my opinion slightly. I mean, I still think it's important for you know, each of us to read books by, you know, by authors of any gender, whatever gender, the opposite gender. But the more I kind of inhabit this character, and that's how I do, right? I have to inhabit the character. It's very much like a method acting approach. The more I realize, you know, we're all human beings. These differences are just, they're anatomical. this may be offensively broad. This assertion, maybe a bit offensively general, I don't know, and I am a little worried for when or if this book comes out. I am a little worried about how it will be received, and I've only developed this worry in the last year because of how the political climate has changed, the discussion around gender and equality. That's developed. I like to think of myself as very progressive in this regard. I was raised by women. I was raised by a mother. I have two older sisters, and I have a wife. So I like to think understanding of my fellow human beings that occupy the dis-half side, as we say, the 52% of the population.
Thank you.
这一个访谈应该是我在挺久之前所进行的一次访谈了，所以我能看出来您真的下了一番功夫。
目前呢，我正在写作一本女性视角的书。在创作这一部作品的过程中，我也稍微改变了我的想法。当然，我始终认为去阅读不同性别的作家的书是非常重要的，不管是男性还是女性作家的书都非常值得，只要它是好的书籍，有意义的书籍都值得阅读。在我所创造这一位女性角色的过程中，我运用了一些比较特殊的方法，我也意识到了我们都是人类，我们有一些情感是共通的，但是我有一些担忧。我会担忧，如果这本书出版之后，人们会不会感到他们被冒犯了？我担心评论家会怎么说我。去年世界上发生了很多事情，有政治相关的运动，有气候变化的讨论，也有针对性别平等的活动。我本人是由我的母亲所抚养成人的。我还有两位姐姐，然后我也受到我妻子的影响，所以我认为女性是非在我生活中是非常重要的。女性大概占人口的总人口的52%左右。
Thank you very much. Now to Yao Emei, your last book is also about four women. So, are you trying to call some attention to the women's situation or women's rights?
下一个问题是问姚女士的，在您的一部小说中，主角是四位女性，您是否想通过这样的方式呼吁大家关注中国当代女性的生活状况，或者说是女性权利这个问题？
你说那个小说，至少那篇小说没有这个意思，那我后来倒写过一个叫《新后的一篇小说》，写的是一个应该说有点乌托邦性质的一个小说，就是一群陷于困境的女人，她们凑在一起过了一种女性公社一样的生活，但最后结局是失败的。我觉得写这种小说也没说是表达我的一种主张啊，我觉得反而有时候是一种设想吧，一种狂想，不是为了表达主张，但是我就是对设计这种生活方式蛮感兴趣的。
Well, at least the novel that you mentioned is not about thought about female rights.But I have, in my another novel, Westgate Hill, which is a utopia-like novel, it is kind of related to this topic. In this novel, the women, they are caught up in kind of dilemma, and those women gather together to form a female utopian community, but their experiment failed in the end. I would rather regard my way of writing this kind of novel as a conception or as some exploration. It is not about expressing my opinion.
Thank you very much. And last but not least, Zhou Jianing. You define your writing as magic realism? Okay, because this is something that I read some critics saying that. Okay. So the question was if you think that, if you think that this gender can fit your kind of writing, since it is a gender from Latin America, mostly. Okay. So you don't see yourself writing in this gender. So in this topic, how do you define your kind of writing? Do you have a definition?
我接下来的一个问题是问周佳宁女士的， 因为我在阅读一些评论家的文章中，他们那些评论家把你称作魔幻现实主义作家。魔幻现实主义其实是源自于拉丁美洲的一个文学流派。现在我知道了你不认同这样的看法，那么请问您如何定义自己的写作风格？
我自己是很喜欢读拉美的作家的小说，非常喜欢。我如果可以写成那样的话，我会觉得很开心的。但我风格完全不是这样。自己定义自己的风格，定义风格不是一个作家要给自己下定义的一个工作。对我来说，我觉得我是希望自己可以写出的小说呢，是不仅我自己没有办法定义风格，然后可以让评论家也得要费一番功夫才能够进行一个归类，或者说最好的情况是呢，没有这个类别，这可不太可能，一定可以被归类的，但是呢，得让他们觉得有点困难。
First of all, I myself like very much the works by Latin American writers, and I would feel extremely happy if I could write something like that. But I don't think writers should define their works. I don't think I should give my works a definition or classification. And what I am trying to do is to write something that is difficult or impossible for the criticisms.Or for the readers to define, to classify.
Thank you very much. So now I open the floor to the audience. If you want to make some question, please feel free to do it.
现在是观众提问互动时间，请大家积极提问。
我不知道，就作为嘛，看过有没有看过那个《三体》，就是那个莫言的那个，就是我想问一下你们各自对莫这本书，啊不是不是，不好意思，是我就那本书，啊，
是《三体》吗？
对，《三体》，对，然后就对这本书的理解，就是因为我，就是我说实话，我看不懂。
My question is about a novel named Three Bodies. It is a scientific fiction written by a Chinese science fiction writer named Liu Cixin. And I am wondering if any writer here has read that book. And if so, what is your thinking about the book?
Gavin 没有读过这本书
，Halina
Three Bodies， Halina 也没有，
应该就只有我一个人在这里读过这本书，但我觉得蛮可惜，因为其实，三体刚出来的时候，也不刚出来吧，我记得我2012年的时候从上海坐飞机去都柏林的路上，然后我是在飞机上看了三体的第一本和第二本，非常非常好看，因为特别是当你就是脱离。我的那个环境在空中的时候，你的那个阅读体验就是会让你，就是会让你去想，人类的存在到底是怎么回事情。但我觉得这个书怎么会看呢？但是，因为它是一个，我觉得所有的科幻小说都应该是很容易能够被人接受的，而且就是每次有国外的作家问我说有什么好的科幻作家推荐的话，我是一定会就是。
I feel a bit pity about Three Bodies. I first read this book in 2012 on a plane from Shanghai to Dublin, and I read the first and second books of it on the plane. I feel like that it is quite a special experience to read in the air, because you are away from the earth and you are above in the sky. This kind of environment kind of lead me into thinking about the question of existence of human beings. And I think that scientific novels are quite easy to understand. And every time, if some foreign writers ask me what kind of Chinese book I should recommend, I would recommend this book.
我跟你感觉差不多，虽然不自己说看不懂，但是我没有看完。这个世界上总有一些书我没有办法看完，我很感兴趣，但是我看很多遍，就我就是有点这样子偏食的一个人。I
feel the same. I agree with you. I also read Three Body, but I didn't finish it. I am a picky person in terms of food as well as books. 各位老师好，然后我有个问题是想问 Gavin 的，因为我刚刚有听说您是在大学里面教授那个小说的，或者是文学，然后我想了解一下在那边的大学是，教授这个小说是怎么样去，是一般是教授哪一些点，points。然后是怎样去训练学生的这个技巧啊，或者什么
？Thank you. My question is to Gavin. I heard that you teach novel and all literature in university. So I am wondering, how do you teach literature or novel in your university? What kind of techniques that you can teach for the students in terms of writing novel?
It's a process of demystification. It's a kind of a contradictory series of lessons that I try to impart, because on one hand I try to demystify writing. I try to break down novels and short stories and prose writing generally into six basic elements.So briefly, location, description, character description, action, dialogue, symbol, and exposition. And then I work through the importance of shape. Before we study the time-honored shapes that all the great stories of the world have been mapped onto.And then I try and encourage them to kind of look outside the time-honored shapes and explore different shapes. So that's the demystification process. But I also try to get my students to understand that writing is a mystical process too. It's about getting into a state of mind. It's about kind of spiraling up all these mysterious things that...comprise the self, like, I don't know, memory, our influences, wisdom, knowledge, things like this. I try to get the students to understand that writing is hard work, but the hard work is when you begin, it's before you hit that point where you kind of enter this.Transcendental state where you can't stop yourself, you can't stop tinkering with the object.
对我来讲，教小说或者说是学习小说，其实是一个解构的过程，它是一个充满矛盾的过程。我会让学生从六个不同的维度去解读一部小说。这六个不同的维度包括地点、角色、对话、动作等等。我也会提醒我的学生，写小说最重要的就是要去进入一种精神状态，去与自我组成的不同部分去进行一场实验。我不知道如何能够更好地去表达这一点，也许是与记忆、与影响、与其他因素等等影响自我的其他因素去做实验。我也会提醒我的学生，写作是一个很困难的事情，但是它难就难在你
刚刚开始写作，还没有去触碰到最重要、最关键的那一个点的时候，而当你跨过了这样的一个临界点，你可能就能够更轻松地去抓住一些本质的东西。
Thank you very much for your questions.
Thank you. I have a question for Halina. It's very evident that Czech male writers such as Ivan Prima, Milan Kundera, or Bohumil Hrabal are more famous than Czech female writers. So, what do you think, how to help those female writers to gain the same prestige as those male writers? And what's your favorite Czech female writers, except yourself?
我的这个问题是问哈里娜的。其实就捷克作家来说，捷克的男性作家例如米兰昆德拉等人远远比女性作家更为有名。您对于如何帮助捷克女性作家去获取更大的文学声誉有什么样的看法？或者说是您能不能告诉我您最喜欢的捷克女性作家是谁呢？
You see that I am not so young woman, but Bohumil Hrabal and Milan Kundera and Ivan Prima is older man than me. So I started a new period and now I am female famous writer, the first.
Maybe you can see it, I actually年纪也不年轻了，但是米兰昆德拉呢，他比我更，他生活在一个更远的一个时代中，所以现在已经很少，很少，现在的女性已经很少去读米兰昆德拉了。现在是一个新的时代，我就是一位著名的女性作家，我就是第一。
Thank you. So I think that our time is.Gone now, and that we need to finish the session. Thank you very much for everyone that came here to listen to this panel. Thank you authors for being here, for participating and exchanging your ideas with us. And have a nice day. Thank you.
Thank you.